Hello and welcome to another edition of It's About Money. I'm Nanette Nokan and thanks for joining us. If this is the first time you've tuned in, we're a program that discusses a number of different financial topics. We aim to help you get motivated and educated about different financial topics to get your financial picture in order. Today my guest is Kenneth Gracie. He's an investment specialist with the New England Group and he is here to talk with us about education planning. Thanks for joining us, Ken.
It's my pleasure.
You've been in the business for a number of years, haven't you?
20 years.
20 years.
Next month will be 20 years.
Oh, congratulations. That's wonderful.
April 29th.
All right. What made you choose to specialize in education planning?
Well, when my son was coming up, I started to realize that saving money for education wasn't the only thing. And really what I specialize in is helping people get through the college financial aid process so that they can get all the money they can legally qualify for and do it in such a way that they don't ruin their retirement also. Hmm. Because the two go hand in hand, in my opinion.
Sure, absolutely.
When your kids are 17, 18 years old and they're ready to go to school, it's a very stressful time for parents. And I know the next thing on their mind is, after I educate the kids, what do I want to do?
Mm-hmm.
And it's 99.9% of the time, I want to retire.
Sure.
So it's a very expensive process, getting the kids through school, and the choices people make to educate their children can affect their future for years. So I help them with those choices.
That's great. When should parents start coming to see you to prepare for financial planning?
Freshman year.
Okay.
Yep.
And what are the steps that you go through with them in order to prepare for it? I mean, what kinds of things do you go through? I mean, assets, liabilities, things like that?
We start with the basics of what the parents' income, assets, liabilities, if the children have any money in their name. Are grandparents going to be in the picture? And I do a detailed analysis of their retirement.
Mm-hmm.
It's difficult to get people to come in when their kids are freshmen. I usually don't see them until they're juniors or seniors because they don't feel there's a sense of urgency.
Sure, put their head in the sand until it's time to do it.
They think financial aid is an easy thing to get. It's just a lot of loans or a lot of free money. That's a real misconception people have. They think financial aid is, where can I get all the free money?
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't always work that way.
Mm-hmm. So some of the things that they may have set up before the time of going to college may be detrimental to their picture.
Well, money's always good to have.
Okay, good.
Always.
I'm glad you said that.
Yes, no matter how you have it, cash is good.
All right. All right. Investments, but financial assets, yes.
Financial assets are always good to have. However, what people don't plan for properly is how to title those assets. Some assets work against you.
Mm-hmm.
If you're wealthy, you really don't need financial aid.
Sure.
If you're poor, there's plenty of aid for you. It's the middle income families that have to do the planning, because as usual, it's the middle income families that get
zapped.
Biggest bill.
You're right. That's right.
No matter what area of life they're in, we pay the most. Right, but the proper planning can help you qualify for more financial aid.
Mm-hmm.
Financial aid usually comes in several forms. First, what everybody wants is the free money.
Okay.
All right, and that's the grants and scholarships.
Mm-hmm.
Then there are loans and work study.
Mm-hmm.
Now, for federal aid, there's two kinds. There's the colleges have their own money,
okay.
And then you want to get money from the federal government too, and that you have to qualify for. There's a formula for that. And it's called the Congressional Methodology.
Okay.
So right away, you know, if it came out of Congress, it's not simple.
Right, that's right.
Okay, so if you know how the system works and you start soon enough and you know the rules of the game, you can make it work for you instead of be surprised by it.
So the congressional formula only takes into account your financial picture, nothing to do with merit or intelligence or any skills or
that's
talents
correct.
You might have.
Yes.
But the college might provide something.
Oh, absolutely.
That
yeah, that's another side. And me as a planner, I don't have control of that side.
Mm-hmm.
All right, that's up to the financial aid officer.
Sure.
And you have to think of colleges as a business. Don't think of it as these lofty towers of higher education.
Mm-hmm.
They're in the business of filling up a classroom, collecting tuitions, and graduating good students. Mm-hmm. That's their business.
True.
Because they want to have a nice, large alumni group.
Sure, to give them money back. To give scholarships back to those kids that need school.
I graduated from the University of Dayton, mm-hmm. and I get two, three, sometimes four letters a year asking for some money.
Sure.
You know, and I send some money in every once in a while. It's okay. I don't mind. But if the school graduates good students, it enhances their reputation.
Absolutely.
And they have a big alumni base, mm-hmm. and it helps refill their coffers.
Sure, that's true.
Yeah. So college selection is probably the most important, thing. You want to find the schools that have money.
Sure. Okay.
If you have a bright child, mm-hmm. good grades, good SAT scores, mm-hmm. Schools compete. For good students, just like companies compete for good employees.
Absolutely, right. It's a very good analogy to compare that against companies. But keep going.
That's exactly what it is. Uh-huh. So if parents can think of colleges as a business, and find the businesses, the colleges that have the most money, mm-hmm. to give, if you have a bright child, it could make a huge difference.
So let's go to the second step. You talked about what. The congressional formula comes up with some, federal aid, and then what
yes.
the colleges come up. Then there are loans. What type of loans are available to children and parents?
Pretty much the most common loan is the Stafford loan.
Mm-hmm.
All right, and you're going to find that you get it in two ways. There's a subsidized and unsubsidized Stafford loan.
Mm-hmm.
Freshman year, I believe it's a maximum, I think it's $2,800.
Yeah, it's not going to fund the whole bill.
Right? No, it isn't. Okay. No, not at all. And subsidized means the payments are deferred until after graduation,
mm-hmm.
And the taxpayers, us, mm-hmm. you and me, we pay the interest.
During the time of deferment.
During the time of deferment.
Right.
Then there is the unsubsidized, mm-hmm. and most everybody can qualify for an unsubsidized. That's where payments are deferred mm-hmm. until graduation. However, the interest accrues.
I see. Okay.
All right. So depending on what your needs are, you may or may not want those kinds of loans.
Sure.
You always have to have Plan B in mind. There are PLUS loans.
Mm-hmm.
That's parent loans to undergraduate students.
Mm-hmm.
If the parents have to take out loans, typically the rates are about in the 8% range.
Mm-hmm.
And so what parents have to plan is how much debt are they willing to go into.
Okay. And that's when the retirement picture comes into play.
Oh, does it ever.
Because you have to pay it back.
it's a loan, absolutely.
Right. Absolutely.
It's not free money.
Right.
And the parent loans have to start, paying it back immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you have to be careful how much debt you take on.
Sure.
Because if you have to reduce your savings mm-hmm. into your 401k plans, for example, how is that going to affect you?
Mm-hmm.
So what I find is that people who have bright children, the college or the high school counselors, they start recommending the expensive schools.
Mm.
All right, and they put some things in the kids' minds, and before you know it, the kids are they want to go to the $20,000, $25,000, $30,000 a year schools. And nobody asked the parents, can you afford this?
Hmm. You can't send me to that school. What's the matter with you?
Well, you have to be careful because sure. What you do now mm-hmm. affects your retirement.
Oh, sure. And also the child, actually, if the child takes on some of this burden, when they graduate, they've got this massive loan structure.
Well, I can't think of anything worse than having a youngster graduate college with $30,000, $40,000, $50,000
of debt. Sure.
What a way to start out life.
Right. Can you even afford to buy a car, a house? You're already in debt.
Yeah, well, and then the kids move in back in with the parents.
Intention was to ship them out, now they're back.
Intention was
right?
to get them out, and now they're back home.
Right.
So planning soon enough, mm-hmm. you'll know the answers to the questions before they ask you.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll be able to decide on how much education you choose to afford as a parent.
Mm-hmm.
Parents think that, my kids are going to get, just let them get all the loans.
Sure.
Let them take out loans.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it doesn't work that way.
Sure. Because sometimes you have bright kids where the parents didn't do any planning. They want to go to college, but because their parents are in the middle class or a little bit wealthy side, the children can't get any aid, then what do they do? I mean, they're stuck. You know, they want a future, but the parents get in the way because they did, number one, they didn't help plan.
Right.
Number two, their income and their assets may be more than what the child could qualify for.
Mm-hmm.
And that becomes a very tough situation.
Again, it's the middle income family that hasn't saved that's going to have the biggest problem.
Mm-hmm.
If they save money in the child's name, 35% of the child's assets goes against them.
Right.
They have to use 35% of child's assets. Money in a parent's name, you only have to use 5.64%.
Right. It's more favorable. Right.
It's a huge difference.
Sure.
Huge difference.
It's amazing because people say, well, we'll put it in a uniform transfer, uniform gift to minors account because of the tax benefits. But they forget about what happens when the child's ready to go to college and the impact it has on the value of the money. It really shrinks quite a bit.
Yeah, it does. Now, if you've been able to save the whole tuition, it doesn't matter where the money is.
Sure, absolutely.
Okay, but I haven't met too many families who've been able to do that.
Right, yeah.
It's just a lot of money.
Sure,
And when you have a young family, your income usually isn't at its peak.
Sure.
So you're trying to figure out how you're going to buy diapers, let alone save enough money.
Sure.
So what happens, when the kids are ready for school, the parents are usually in their peak earnings years.
Mm-hmm.
Some parents have saved money for college, some haven't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Right? If you haven't saved it, you've got some serious decisions to make. Because what are you going to do?
Right.
How is it going to affect you? Mm-hmm. Do you have to stop saving into your retirement plan for 4, 5, 6, 7 years or reduce your savings? And how is that going to affect you?
Right.
Let me give you a good story. People came in a few years ago. Father was a college teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Father's an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
They had a pretty good income, saved a modest amount of money for their kids. But bright boys, they both wanted to go to engineering school, to an expensive engineering school, which is all right because when they graduate, they'll get better jobs.
Mm-hmm.
But their parents were just bent, determined to get them through undergraduate and pay for graduate school.
Okay.
That's what they wanted to do,
sure.
at least to start with.
Sure.
After we did the analysis, make a long story short, it showed that they would have to work until they were at least 70.
Oh, gosh.
No choice.
Right.
They would
right.
have to.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, you folks better go home.
Mm-hmm.
Talk this over.
Mm-hmm.
If this is what you want to do, here's the path we need to take. If that's not what you want to do, then we have to work on another path.
Sure.
Well, they called me back about a week later,
mm-hmm.
and they said, yes, that's what we want to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that wouldn't have been my first choice, but it's theirs,
sure.
and they know it
right,
now,
right.
so they can they're prepared for it. They're not going to be surprised
sure.
by it. So we can do good financial planning now, and it's not financial panic.
Right, right.
And reacting to things. Now they're prepared and they know it and they're ready for it.
Sure. Actually, that's the beauty of planning, no matter what type. You know, you just know what to expect. And you can make an educated decision as to whether or not that's you can accept the consequence of what you plan for.
Sure.
As opposed to, like you said, being surprised and panicking as a result of what you've done.
Mm-hmm.
So now you've talked about the middle income. You know, what is like wealthy? What would you define as wealthy and don't even bother for financial aid or any type of?
If you're earning close to six figures, right, and it's based on adjusted gross income.
Sure, right.
So whatever we can do to get the adjusted gross down,
mm-hmm.
do that kind of planning, you're probably not going to get any need-based financial aid. Need-based.
Right.
So we have to do a whole different kind of planning then.
Mm-hmm.
If you're not going to get any need-based financial aid from the federal government, for example, what other options do you have? Where's the money going to come from?
Right.
How are you going to finance it?
Right.
And what schools have money to give?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So we always start with plan A.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now let's see if plan A is going to work.
Right.
And we better have some backups.
Right,
some children want to go to private schools.
Mm-hmm.
We have to see if it's going to be affordable.
Sure. So it looks like when they're going to make choices, not only should they be looking at the programs they want to have, or you know, benefits that are available in the colleges, like activities and things like that, but also they should be looking at the financials of the college and what kind of money they can.
Oh, absolutely.
So
absolutely. I didn't bring my book with me today, but see if I can remember.
You didn't.
This. No, I'll have to remember all this.
All right.
I think it was Princeton, pretty good school.
Sure. Yeah.
Not cheap.
Right.
But I believe the number was 85% of the students who applied for financial aid were judged to have need.
Mm-hmm.
And 100% had their need fully met.
You're kidding.
Yes,
oh 100%. Oh my gosh, that's impressive.
Yeah, it is. Huh. It is. Now, the flip side of that, a local college, a SUNY college,
mm-hmm.
Brockport,
mm-hmm.
I think it was 70 or 75%, don't quote me on that number, of the students who applied were judged to have need,
mm-hmm.
and 50% had their need fully met.
Mm,
and this number came out of the Peterson's Guide.
Mm-hmm.
You can buy this book in any bookstore. Mm-hmm. It's about $25 or so, and it's a very, very handy book to have
because
mm-hmm. you'll see, it shows you what schools give the most money.
Sure.
And I use that book all the time
mm-hmm.
to help parents choose.
I think it's available in the local library, too.
In the library? Yeah, absolutely. Sure. Libraries have it. I haven't looked it up on the Internet, but I bet there are sources on the Internet, too.
Sure. That's interesting. So it's really not an indication of the pricing of the school, but what kind of statistics they have in terms of giving out money
yeah.
for children. Yeah,
exactly.
That's true. So don't rule it out just because it's over $25,000.
No, don't rule it out at all. Another example, single mom, her daughter was pretty bright, had 1,300, 1,400 on her SATs.
Mm-hmm.
She wanted to go to this school in, I believe it was Kentucky. Mm-hmm. I forgot the name of it now, but it was a private school.
Mm-hmm.
They wanted her. It was about $20,000 a year at the time. They wanted this girl badly.
Mm-hmm.
So what did they do? They cut her a pretty good deal.
Sure.
$10,000 a year scholarship, not loans.
Right. Free money.
Free money.
Yes.
That's the good money.
Right.
Free money. $10,000 a year for the 4 years
uh-huh.
and guaranteed the tuition not to increase.
Huh.
So this family's expected family contribution was about $10,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
And they could afford that.
Right, okay. Right.
So what it did is it brought the cost of that private school down to the cost of the SUNY college.
Sure.
So she was able to go because she was a bright girl.
Sure. That's
so
good.
SAT scores are real important.
Right. So really the kids really have to help themselves from early on, or the parents have to help the kids set some good study habits and make sure that, you know, they have the grades to help them out in college.
The parent's job is to put a little bit of money away.
Mm-hmm.
The child's job is to get as good grades as possible.
Yeah. Sometimes, you know, when people don't have children yet, I encourage them to try to beef up their retirement planning when they don't know what kind of support they want to give the kids yet. Because
mm-hmm.
Everybody knows they're going to want to retire at some point, whether it's in their 70s, 60s, or 50s, we don't know.
Yep.
But the sooner you start building that nest egg, the more choices you're going to have.
Yeah, that's a good point. The more money you put away, the sooner you put money away, of course, it's always better because the time value of
sure.
money.
Absolutely.
So it's good to front load your retirement plans, I guess, before you start a family,
mm-hmm.
so that because then you can't save as much usually.
Sure. And you could take a breather from saving from retirement and then dedicate that to college and whatnot.
Sure.
So, mm-hmm. yeah.
So the whole key to this, Nanette, is to know what you're expected to pay,
mm-hmm.
what the government and the schools think you can afford. And most people, if they haven't prepared for it, are shocked by that number.
What? Where do they expect me to get this money?
Well, I do 10, 12 seminars a year on this, and I'm doing another one this Wednesday evening at BOCES. And one of the things I do for people, if they want to see me the first time, is I calculate what their expected family contribution
mm-hmm.
Will be based
sure.
on their current circumstances without doing any planning or mm-hmm. reshuffling of assets.
Sure, sure. Kind of like what the FAFSA form kind of does.
Yeah,
yes.
exactly.
Uh-huh.
And if you don't know that number,
mm-hmm.
and you've done your FAFSA form yourself and you send it in,
mm-hmm.
and you get that number back in about 6 weeks, it's going to slay you.
Better sit down.
you better have a comfortable chair. That's right, to either be sitting in or fall into. Because
right.
the number is big.
Sure.
What they feel you can afford, I haven't met a parent yet who's agreed with it.
Sure. And the interesting thing about that is you have the college needs there, and then there's some incidental costs, you know, the traveling costs.
Mm-hmm.
Child needs money, extra money here and there for whatever they're doing at school or extracurricular activities.
Yeah, you're right.
semester abroad. I mean, things like that that pop up. And, you know, if you plan so tightly, it makes it really difficult.
You're absolutely right. The tuition is the biggest part, room and board, of course, but it's the incidentals. People who put their kids through school have told me that you should tack on another 5 to 10%.
Sure, right.
Because, you know, they need laundry money.
Sure, that's right. Got to get the pizza. And
got to get pizza on Friday
good thing
night.
The beer is not a concern in New York State yet. You're going to be 21, got to wait your junior.
That's right. That's
I have
right.
to worry about the beer money for the time being.
Absolutely. So in transportation, some kids want to go as far away from home as they can. Other kids want to live at home.
Sure.
So if children are looking at California schools.
Mm-hmm.
Right, well. Gosh, parents, now you've got to figure another couple $1,000s a year for transportation.
Sure.
Can you afford it?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we have to take all these pieces and put them into a blender and see how it comes out.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have to start making choices. And if you start early enough, you know what the government is expecting you to pay.
Mm-hmm.
And we've done everything we can do to change your assets around, to get your expected family contribution as low as possible, and choose the colleges that you would like your children to apply to, starting with their first choice, and have a few backups that are affordable, and then when the time comes, you're ready for it, you're prepared, you know the answers before they ask the questions, and that's what good planning is.
Sure.
And so that you'll be able to do both.
Mm-hmm. That's great. And of course, these days, you know, with the trillions of dollars passing on to the next generation, if their grandparents are willing to give gifts, they can.
Yeah.
I mean, there's no unlimited gifting to colleges for tuition, so the grandparents can really be gifting those, in addition to making a gift for room and board.
Yeah.
You know, so it's certainly an option that's available. You know, one of the things I find is when people want to help pay for education is they sell the asset in their tax bracket and gift the money. I'm saying gift the money to the child, sell it in the bracket the next day, and the child gets to pay at the lower rate.
Yeah.
You know, so there's some things you can do to help yourself while you're helping somebody else.
You have to know the rules of the game.
Yeah.
And so you can make the rules work for you instead of against you.
Yeah, that's right.
And I know so a lot of times grandparents, they feel good giving money to the children.
Mm-hmm.
But if they have too much money in their name, remember 35% gets added to the family contribution.
Sure. Just give it, then sell it, then it's not in the name.
Yeah, or either that or just write the check to the school.
Sure, directly.
When the time comes.
Sure, absolutely.
You have choices,
sure.
But you have to know what options you have so that you can choose the ones that benefit you.
Sure, absolutely.
And always be legal.
Yes, that's right. That's a good thing to do. Might have an education, but if you're in jail, that's no good.
I know. I complete a lot of FAFSA forms, and many times, you know, people want to fudge the numbers.
Wow.
You know, and, well, what if we did this and that? I said, look, the fine, if you're caught lying on the FAFSA form, you're caught.
Right.
The penalty, it says in bold black letters on it, is up to $10,000 and or prison.
Oh, my gosh. I've never paid attention to that. But
keep it honest.
Yeah, really, absolutely.
And I'm not signing my name to a fudged financial aid form.
Exactly.
But you have to know that the financial aid form is kind of like a tax return.
Mm-hmm.
You can fill it out one way and you get one answer. You can do it another way and you can get another answer.
Sure.
And both ways are legal.
Right, that's right.
So if you know how those things work, you can rearrange your assets.
Sure.
See, assets that you may have that you do not want to use for tuition, what do you do with them? And there are legal things you can do with those assets to legally not report it on financial aid forms. And I stress the term legal.
Legally, right.
Yes.
So you can preserve it for the other goals that you want
to
dedicate that money towards. Mm-hmm. Right.
There's a big difference. Some people, one lady came in, she was divorced.
Mm-hmm.
She completed her financial aid form herself.
Mm-hmm.
And she made my fee back 20 times. Because she included her former husband on the form.
Oh, dear.
All right, and you don't need to do that.
Right.
If you're divorced or separated, it's the custodial parent.
Sure, that's
if
right.
If you have joint custody, you can use the parent who has the least income and least assets.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, that just brought the, their financial aid picture right into view then when I changed it and corrected it. Mm-hmm. And so her son was able to afford to go to, I think it was Cornell.
Oh, really? Oh, great. A wonderful school.
Yes, it is. Oh, that's your school.
Of course, I'm a little biased.
Not much. No, just a little bit. Just a little.
Well, that's great. So sometimes, it does help to go to a professional to find out what kind of options you have rather than just blindly submitting an application and losing, available money.
You could
money.
Be making some honest mistakes.
Sure.
Just because you don't know. I don't do my own tax return. Mm-hmm. I'm in the financial business, but I won't do my tax return.
Sure.
I take it to an accountant who knows the ins and the outs,
sure.
all
Absolutely.
The details of taxes, and that's his specialty.
Sure.
And he sees things that I would have overlooked.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Because nothing is simple today. Just absolutely nothing.
Sure, yeah.
And everything's complicated.
And they're talking about the simplification of the tax code. Yeah, right.
It'll be different, but it won't be simpler.
Yeah, that's right.
That's right.
That's for sure.
Now, parents... single parents who are thinking of remarrying mm-hmm. and send their children to college mm-hmm. Probably shouldn't, unless they're marrying somebody really poor or really rich.
I see. So hold it off until the college graduation happens.
Well, the reason is if you remarry, now you have to include your new spouse's income and assets
exactly.
on the financial aid forms.
Right, right.
All right. You don't have to include the child's mother or father.
Sure. Right.
It
right.
doesn't seem right to me.
Right. I'm with you.
But if you remarry, you have to include the new spouse's income sure. and assets, mm-hmm. which could just knock you right out of the box.
Sure. But we're not giving advice as to marriage and things like that here, but you're right.
Not
it's
me.
Something to consider.
Just to consider. That's
all. Right. Absolutely. Well, this has been a delightful conversation. Thanks for joining me. The time just kind of went along so fast.
Are we finished already?
Yes, we sure are.
Oh.
Thank you very much. Ken Gracie
Thank
is
you.
An investment specialist with New England Financial in Henrietta, or actually Brighton, I should
yes.
say. And thank you, our viewers, for joining us today. If you'd like to send us comments or questions, please email me at nnocon@aol.com. Until next time.